didn't see you there. Sorry. Well, that is the downside to taking bong rips. Wash some that one down. This ad brought to you by Rainier. It's not, but it could be. Send me money. Product placement. What product? I drink Rainier. Today we're going to be reading a selection from one of my favorite authors, Patrick McManus. Drugs are bad, okay? This is one of his better books. He's also got The Grasshopper Trap and like 100 other ones. Today we are going to be reading. Let's have a look. Let's see what we got to offer. We have Blowing Smoke. It's good. Poof. No Eyebrows. Also good. I Fish, Therefore I Am. And that really speaks to me. The Cat and the Cat Burglar. I think because you're probably going to hear a cat meow once or twice. That's the one we should go with. Okay. That's the one we're going to do. I've read this book too many times. It's falling apart. 33. Hey, are you settled in? Yeah, your blanket of choice. Right, ready? The Cat and the Cat Burglar. The sound of a vase crashing to the floor in the living room snapped my wife and me bolt right up in bed. It's the cat, Bun hissed. You forgot to put the cat out again. Oh. Go back to sleep, I said. It's probably only another burglar. You're trying to make excuses. I know it's the cat. You forgot to put it out. Well, I'll prove it's a burglar, I growled. Crawling out of bed and switching on the hall light. As I expected, a dark figure was wandering about the living room. Hey, you. The burglar pointed a questioning finger at his chest. Yeah, you, I snapped. Do you see anyone else in the living room? Now come here. I want to prove to my wife that you're only a burglar and not the dang cat. Besides, there's no point in eyeing the TV. It blew a tube in California during the Miss America pageant, which made two of us. The burglar shuffled down the hall. A can of blackjack mugger spray trained on me. Don't try no funny stuff. It was only a little joke. Good. I've had a hard night. How come your house is so empty? We've had a lot of other burglaries, I explained. For a while, they were so frequent, we thought about asking the burglars to each take a number, so there wouldn't be so many here at one time. What did I say about the funny stuff? Sorry. Say I'd appreciate it if you would poke your head into the bedroom there, and so my wife will know you're there, only a burglar and not a cat. The burglar peered cautiously around the door and looked at my wife. Oh, thank goodness you were only a burglar, Bun said. The cat makes such a terrible mess when it gets left in. My nice rug in the living room. Can it, lady, the burglar ordered. I ain't got no time to hear no cat messes. Have it your way, Bun said. But I really should tell you about Felix. I said, can it? Well, You're going to be rude. I'll just go back to sleep. The last few burglars we had were at least civil. Sheesh, do I ever pick up. The burglar moaned. Then he turned to me. Say, you're the outdoor writer, aren't you? Well, sort of, I replied. Yeah, that's what I was told. All you outdoor writers got big gun collections. Let's have a look at yours. My gun collection. For years, I'd worried that some burglar would discover my secret gun room and clean it out. Now, under the threat of bodily harm, I was being forced to reveal my hoard of priceless firearms. Oh, all right. Follow me, I told the burglar. I led the way to the den, pressed a hidden button, and a wall panel slid silently back, revealing the secret gun room. The burglar whistled his approval at this bit of architectural ingenuity. And there's my fabulous collection, I said, pointing to the gun cabinet. That's it? The burglar gasped, awestruck. Yeah, that's it. The fence will pay you handsomely for these fine guns. Your fortune is made, I'm afraid. Unlocking the doors to the gun cabinet, I decided to take one last desperate chance to save my collection. Why don't you sit down and make yourself comfortable, I said to the burglar. And I'll tell you about these guns. Should you decide to keep them for your own enjoyment, knowing their histories will increase the pleasure of owning them. I'm glad you approve. Apparently, approving of this suggestion, the burglar flopped into an armchair while I removed one of my favorite rifles from the gun cabinet. If you were a connoisseur of fine guns, I began, I would first tie a bib around your neck so you wouldn't drool all over your clothes when I showed you this little 30-30. Notice, if you will, the grip of the stock. Yeah, that caused that termites. Or did your dog chew at it? Do the contrary, I replied. This is custom checking on the grip, which, in all modesty, I must admit, I accomplished myself with a ball peen hammer and a 5-penny nail. True, the exquisiteness of the pattern is detracted from somewhat by the wrappings of baling wire and electrician's tape on the stock. You may also have noticed that the barrel is slightly bent to the left and down. Oh, shit. You may also notice that the barrel is slightly bent to the left, downward. But I assure you, it's not more than an inch out of alignment. I won't go into how the stock got splintered and the barrel bent, except to say that it saved me from a nasty fall. The gun is still remarkably accurate. However, provided you make the necessary adjustments in your aim, I assume you've studied calculus. No? Well, perhaps one of those pocket calculators would work just as well, although a bit bothersome on a running shot. Feigning disgust, the burglar motioned for me to return the 30-30 to the rack. He pointed to another rifle. What's that, a 30-06? Close, I said. Actually, it's a 30-02, one of the predecessors of the 30-06. There was a little problem with the locking mechanism on the bolt, and the model was discontinued when it was discovered that the breech velocity sometimes exceeded the muzzle velocity. Otherwise, it's perfectly safe, as long as you don't forget to jerk your head away at the instant you squeeze the trigger. My grandfather once killed a trophy elk with the bolt when the animal tried to slip past him 40 yards to the rear. But what kind of shooting takes considerable practice, and I don't recommend it for beginners. A hint of gloom had settled upon the burglar's features as he gestured irritably for me to return the 30-02 to the cabinet. I looked down. Wonderful old side-by-side, 12-gauge shotgun. I also had inherited from my grandfather. Old One-Ear, they called him. On my 14th, as I told the burglar, the shotgun had one interesting little eccentricity, which was that on about every third shot, both barrels discharged simultaneously, regardless of which trigger was squeezed. Troublesome. Since I weighed only a 125 at the time, most student pilots log list.
Damn it.
Since I weighed only a 125 at the time, most student pilots log less flight time than I did on an average hunt. And their landings are a good deal softer. As for the effects of these double-barreled kicks on my anatomy, the high school football coach once observed me coming out of the showers and leaped to the conclusion that I can... had leaped to the conclusion that I had contracted a progressive disease in which one shoulder takes on the general shape and color of her, of a Hubbard squash. God damn it. Can't get through this without laughing my ass off. And leaped to the conclusion that I had contracted a progressive disease in which one shoulder takes on the general shape and color of a Hubbard squash. There was also the problem that my nose, from week to week, seemed to drift about my face, sometimes anchoring under my left eye, and, at other times, settling a course for the center of my forehead. This feature was nicely complemented by my right ear, which appeared to have been run through a pasta-shaping machine. I used this fine old gun for nearly 20 years, I told the burglar. But people were always asking me about the accident, and I got tired of telling them I had saved my commanding officer in North Korea by throwing myself on a hand grenade. The burglar stifled a yawn with his fist. Come on, guy. I ain't got all night. You know what's speeded up these histories, huh? Right, I said. I'll think you'll like this next one. Ominously. I unracked the single-shot 22. That had been given to me by my parents when I was 11 years old. Never was a gun given more tender care than that one. I cleaned and oiled it 3 times a day, whether it had been fired or not, and never allowed a speck of dust to settle on it for more than a minute. So, how come it's all rusted and pitted? The burglar asked, his voice fairly reeking with exasperation. Perhaps because I was delaying my account with the 22, in an unsuccessful attempt to wrench the bolt back. As I told the burglar, a couple of months after the 22 had come into my possession, I was out in the back pasture target practicing on a tin can, when who should show up but a neighbor by the name of Olga Bone Marrow. I didn't much care for girls at the time, and considered Olga to be, in particular, a great nuisance. Ignoring her, I continued to plink away at the can while she directed a torrent of prattle at the back of my head. Suddenly, a single question leaped from the torrent like a sparkling cutthroat from spring runoff. Do you want to come over to my house and play doctor? Olga asked. By sheer coincidence, Olga had hit upon one of my great enthusiasms of the moment, namely, the field of medicine. Such was my passion for the art and science of curing the sick with target practice, and even my beloved 22 were immediately blotted from my consciousness. Attempting to comport myself in a dignified manner appropriate to a serious student of medicine, I raced panting after Olga to her house, where she slipped upstairs to her bedroom, without detection, Mr. and Mrs. Bone Marrow. while I grabbed a window curtain and dried my palms, which were sweating profusely from the... Well, I grabbed a window curtain and dried my palms, which were sweating profusely from the previous exertion. Olga rummaged around under her bed, finally extracting a large flat box. The box for a moment consumed 100% of my attention, for on its lid was printed the word, Doctor. Olga took off the lid, removed a board zigzagged with lines and squares, placed two tiny white wooden figures on the square bearing the title Med School, and then began to shuffle little stacks of cards. Even as I sized up the situation, my interest in the field of medicine began to fall off sharply. It's understandable. I just remembered a previous engagement, I told Olga, and I headed for the door. Hold it, Buster, Olga snapped, adding with ominous vagueness, or I'll tell your pa. Pa, I should point out, was built like a nail keg and had a temper shorter than a gnat's hiccup. No matter what Olga might tell him, I deduced, it wouldn't be good. And it was easy to imagine a hairy nail keg. Hold on. Oh. I deduced it wouldn't be good, and it was easy to imagine a hairy nail keg drop kicking me through the second story window. Still, I was not the sort of person to be intimidated by childish threats, as I immediately demonstrated to an astonished Olga. In fact, In only my first three throws of dice, I got out of med school, interned at a major hospital, and was making big bucks performing cardiovascular surgery. Not only was the game boring, but it lasted slightly longer than the last ice age. By the time it ended, my mental faculties felt as if they had been stir-fried in molasses. I staggered off home and dropped immediately into bed. The next morning, I awoke with a jolt, realizing that somewhere in the fiasco with Olga, I had mislaid my rifle. I left the house so fast the screen door twanged for a week, but the .22 was not to be found. It was as if it had slipped away from my sweaty palms the day before and disappeared down a gopher hole. My grief was monumental, and has lingered even into present day, causing me to still hold the entire medical profession in general distrust and responsible for the loss of my .22. Following spring, I found the rifle on a stack of fence posts where it had wintered over. As a boy, I often read many articles that warned of the ills of failing to clean and oil a gun after each use. But never did I read an article warning against leaving a gun on a stack of fence posts all winter. You would think some shooting editor might have mentioned that at least once. So that's how my .22 got rusted and pitted, I told the burglar, who seemed on the verge of suffering an infarction of some sort. Now, moving right along, this rather peculiar-looking rifle here is actually a .270. I restocked it myself, with the arm from an old rocking chair, and the burglar held up his hand for me to seize. Listen, pal, he said. Maybe I'll just take the TV after all. You can keep them guns. Clearly the man had been touched by my show of affection for these guns, which was what I had hoped for, out of appreciation for his change of heart. I led him back to the living room, loaded him up with the TV, and even tried to warn him when he started out the wrong door. When the ruckus in the yard finally died down, I went back to bed. Is the burglar finished? My wife asked sleepily. I'm afraid so, I said. If the poor devil had had enough sense to drop the TV, he probably could have made it over the back fence before Felix got him. You know, having an attack cat isn't such a bad idea. But if these burglaries ever let up, we're going to have to start buying cat food for them. That's why he's my favorite author. Well, that, my friends, is Pat McManus. Never sniff a gift fish. If you liked this episode. Oh yeah. Money or product. It's up to you. If you enjoyed this and you want to hear more, I'm going to do the whole damn series on Pat McManus, his books. He's my favorite author. The stories are perfect length for this. And give me your thoughts. This is one of one. We'll see if there's two. You guys get to tell me this. This is whatever. It's delicious. No, if you excuse me, I just see a man about a horse.